Welcome, everyone. I'm here with Christian Schicklgruber from the Weltmuseum. Christian, congratulations on being named as a Best in Heritage Laureate for this year, and congratulations on the success of your project. And thank you for spending the time with us so we can get to know your project a little bit more.
Yeah, thank you for the invitation. It's a big honor for me.
Excellent. Maybe we can start by you just giving us a little bit of background on the project, about what its original intentions are and how you've managed to achieve those intentions.
Yeah. Now, maybe I should start to explain the word Weltmuseum. So the Weltmuseum, the institution, was opened in 1928 under the name of Museum of Ethnology. And only 7 or 8 years back, we turned the name into Weltmuseum, as many European ethnographic museums did, to get rid of all this connotation with colonial times and so on. So now Weltmuseum would translate into English as World Museum, which means everything and at the same time nothing, but it gives us the freedom to do whatever we want. Yeah, and a little bit the history behind this prize. Just after the turn of the millennium, we started to close down the museum gallery by gallery because it was completely outmoded, kind of dusty. And we only reopened late autumn 2017 with 14 galleries in our permanent exhibition, redesigned from the ground up.
Incredible. So was it at that point in time that you pivoted as an organization to do a lot more of this, you know, plurality of voices and you know, engagement in different perspectives? Was it during the redevelopment of the museum?
Yeah, no, we really had a very luxurious time frame to work on the concept. So it took really a long time with all the budget problems and stops and so on. Gave us years, us means the 10 curators who worked on the new permanent exhibition, for really thrilling discussions. Mm-hmm. We are still friends, but there were some controversial opinions to bring under one hat. But finally, we defined three main, so to say, principle which guided the installation of these 14 galleries. Maybe the most important, which also gave us this Kenneth Hudson Prize, was the need to talk about the colonial entanglement of ethnographic museums in the past. Second was that an overview of the world in an ethnographic museum is just impossible. And the third was a really need of a plurality of perspectives of narrators talking in the museum.
What would you say was the greatest challenges in developing a museum? I mean, there's a lot of work going on through ICOM and different museum associations now in trying to keep this trust relationship with communities by developing this level of plurality of perspective. But, you know, you were doing this sort of ahead of the trend. And so, you know, what were some of the difficulties that you encountered?
Naya. Might sound strange, but actually we didn't encounter any difficulties. It also, to our surprise, it really went quite smoothly. And the three main guiding principle I mentioned, what I personally like most is really this plurality of perspective. Which means that the museum somehow abdicated as the authority in possession of the truth. So it's not anymore the museum that speaks, but it's also obvious to our visitors. It's split up into 10 different narrators. We are 10 curators, so it's 10 different voices. And as we all know, each narrative also tells about the narrator.
Right.
So it was a personal decision, more or less, of for all of us, which stories to present in the gallery. So each of us had one gallery for him or herself, and two or three worked together on other galleries. In total, it's 14 galleries. Each and every gallery tells a short story only, so we don't follow somehow also the expectations of some of our visitors to get the whole world presented, which is just not possible with, I think it's 3,127 objects. Mm-hmm. So it's short stories only, and like the stones of a mosaic, these stories should create a picture of cultural diversity and so on and so on. Yeah. So each of the curators had the freedom to decide which story to tell. So a very individual decision, and also a very individual narrative. It becomes clear to our visitors because all the texts on the walls of the museums, the name of the curator is given. So it's really a personal thing. But it's not only the curators who have the say, but we also invited so-called voices from our source communities. So in all the galleries, you find video screens where people from outside give comments on what is shown in the gallery. Sometimes very, very critical comments. Again, a big surprise to our visitors. To find somebody on a video screen talking in the museum, demanding to return all the objects because everything was looted and so on. Mm-hmm. But I think we are in the 21st century by now. It's the only way how to do it. Brings some surprises to visitors, these demands and so on, and completely different opinions from what we say. But I think it makes it lively, and it's the only honest way to do it. Yeah. And also when we worked on the concept and on the design of the exhibition as social anthropologist, you are in contact to members of the source communities anyway. And we find ourselves in the position to translate their views of the world into a museum language for our audience. And that's it.
Do you find that at the same time as you're giving this perspective that some people are finding surprising, the opportunity for it to be about dialogue in a way, are you finding though that maybe you're open to a new audience, that there's more of a co-ownership of the museum in terms of, you know, community ownership and communities participating that maybe otherwise you didn't have before? So while you're surprising some, say, visitors, you're opening yourselves up to a greater audience?
This goes with the permanent exhibition, which, yeah, it's nice in a museum, you find objects and texts, mm-hmm. but this shouldn't be all of a museum. What we do now is for special events to invite representatives or members of the source communities to perform in the museum, to get into direct contact with our visitors. And this makes it really, really thrilling and lively.
Yeah, and
so of course you find in the permanent installation all these voices, but also in live acts, and there is the direct interaction and exchange of opinions.
And I would have to think that leads to a more sustainable, trusted organization.
Yeah, definitely. If you open the doors and let people talk without knowing, from our side without even knowing before what they will tell. So sometimes it's even kind of shocking and a surprise for us, but that's how it is.
Yeah. I mean, are you collecting sort of stories and intangible heritage as well as, you know, the objects? So you have events taking place where you're engaging the community and the source communities to perform and participate in dialogue and discourse. Is there a way of capturing the intangible as an artifact also?
Yeah, we capture it, we video film it and make sound recordings, which we keep, but it's not accessible on a permanent basis to our audiences.
Right, but could be used by researchers and, you know.
It's open to anybody. So the museum is open to researchers from wherever they come. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're really surprised to get the key of our storages once we trust them. And I'm always happy if somebody comes. So I'm also curator here.
Right.
And if researchers come from outside to study a certain collection, they definitely know more than I do. So it's a big advantage for the museum when you get specialists on well-defined topics.
Yeah.
So it's not our object and we are sitting on it.
Yes.
But I got the key to the museum, and whoever listens now to this interview, you are highly welcome. Send an email.
Excellent. Yeah, I mean, and that when we think of the museum being a trusted steward of knowledge, then the stewardship versus ownership is a very different thing. And it sounds like you're doing a lot of work to help ensure that everyone understands that this cultural heritage belongs to everyone.
It's a shared heritage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And this, it's, yeah, nowadays it's a slogan even,
yeah,
or a catchword, shared heritage. But it's an important slogan also when it comes to the discussion. And this discussion is led quite intensely in Europe now about restitution. To return everything would mean to give away part of this shared heritage. And that's a topic we are also addressing in our permanent exhibition. There is a demand to return objects like the highlights of our Benin collection, which was definitely looted end of the 19th century. But there are also voices from Benin to keep some here to tell about them, and to tell about them without an object in a museum just doesn't work. And with this dialogue, it's even an institution now, it's called Benin Dialogue. We are really opening new ways, and let's see how it develops. It's kind of an open question right now.
You know, I'm just looking at the time and it passes quickly when we have interesting things to discuss. Christian, thank you so much for spending the time with us, and congratulations again on being named a laureate for this year. Really congratulations on your museum and the work that you're doing. I think it's, particular with the movements that are happening, today. And right now, in terms of equity around the world, I think that it's really important, your approach to, being a trusted source of knowledge, and the way you're engaging communities and the plurality of voices is, very important work, and to me really demonstrates like sort of what a museum should be. So it's been an honor for me to be able to speak with you. And
that's nice to hear. And, as you might know, Vienna is quite a nice city.
Yes.
Another reason to come to Vienna, but come to visit the museum.
Yeah, I would love that.
And so whoever hears this, come and see what we have done. Give your comments, be critical, because that it's nice we know ourselves and important, but to have really good critics and a dialogue might even improve it in the years to come.
That's excellent. That's an amazing statement and sentiment. Thank you.
I thank you.